lot of talk, but no action. Even now there is a lot of talk, but the action is very slow. Yes, there is movement from before. But again, in the defense industry, we chose the option of export first, and then let's build the capabilities and bring it back here when we are ready. I think we cannot sit still. That's the point I'm trying to make. And second is, we need to keep trying till people change. Now the time frames of making the change are shortened, because the pressure is not coming from a revenue-making organization, but from across the system, citizens demand the services. So I think the growth in the domestic market has increased. A lot more players are becoming very visible. Credible players are becoming visible. And the role of middlemen has more or less gone. I think you will see a lot of deployment. Even when the industry started, the reason we had to look outside, because the market was there. The reason we had to look at a service industry was because services is the only way to relate to the market, because the product required your presence physically there. Because there was no internet, there was no connectivity, physically developing a product and putting the money was a very high risk. Today, that has also changed. So I think we are seeing much more acceleration.
My question is regarding
the
sustainability of our market share in the service industry in the world. Some people are of the view that the two main factors that drove our market share was the cost differential and the currency differential with the leading currencies of the world. Some people are of the view now that as we go up the development chain, our cost differential gap will narrow, and so also with our currency differential narrow. So given that, and that the other countries are waiting to pick this up, the market share, how sustainable is our market share in the short term and the long term?
I think if you had asked me this question about 10 years ago, I would have said cost is going to be a very critical factor and we have to keep our cost down. But today, I think the market is not looking for the lowest price, but a very competitive price and the right price for the right deployment. So long as you have brought in the innovation through your own investments, and you are able to scale up and deploy at a speed which is very critical, and the domain competency which you have built up so that you can relate to them and relate to their business very proactively, cost is fourth or fifth in the equation, and they are willing to pay a premium for the kind of capability. The industry today is demanding the right price for the right kind of services they offer in the right quality at the right time. So with this, we are not being benchmarked as a country only on price, but purely as ability to deliver consistently all the time across industries. So to me, the more important thing is to continue to invest, continue to be proactive, and continue to build those intellectual assets which you can monetize through certain cost savings and speed savings for our customers, and that's what is playing out. I think people are investing a lot in this space, and India is at such a large scale that any country wanting to compete with it or compare with it, they'll have to take along. China has not succeeded at all in the last 10 years, 15 years they've been trying this. Language has become a very strong entry barrier. Their practices of intellectual property protection have become a big barrier. So these are all there.
Is it possible to develop or think about, devise a model for innovation so that you can replicate success stories across the board? And if yes, what would be the important components you think of such a model?
I think a model is, you can't say this is the way to think about an idea. Model is with regard to the support systems around it. If you take the technology park next to the IITs as an example, what is the kind of support system it provides? What is the kind of mentoring capability it provides? What is the kind of financial know-how it creates? What is the kind of communication or marketing capabilities you build, legal, etc.? So I think it's a support system which is the model, not the innovation, saying that I have a good idea and I'm willing to try it out. I can't tell you what's the model for a good idea. Anybody who wants to try anything, we must have the flexibility and freedom to do it. But then the processes and the systems around it are very necessary, and people have to participate in that. SEC clusters of innovation taking place today.
Thank you.
I think we are running into short of time, so thank you very much, Mr. Ramadurai. May I now request Mr. Ramadurai to please hand the moment over. Thank you very much. Before I introduce the next speaker, let me again thank Dr. Devi Shetty for his extreme grace. So there's a change of schedule again, and our next speaker will be our Honorable Minister of Agriculture of the State, Mr. Krishna Vairagora. Mr. Vairagora has been a very close friend of NIAS, extremely supportive of our activities, has always been here participating in all our meetings. He is currently, as I said, Minister of State for Agriculture of the Government of Karnataka, independent in charge, as well as the member of the Legislative Assembly of the Vairagora constituency. He's been in office since June 2008. Born in Bangalore, Mr. Vairagora is a graduate from the American University in Washington and the Christ College in Bangalore. He was a project associate at the Ethiopian Embassy in Washington before earning his MA degree, and then worked as an agriculturist in his family-owned farm in Kolar district between 2000 and 2003. In 2003, he again worked as a project associate at the Development Alternatives, and subsequently went on to serve three times as MLA of Karnataka State, twice from Bembidal in Kolar district, and once from the Baitara in Kolar constituency in Bangalore. He has served as the president of the Karnataka Pradesh Youth Congress between 2007 and 2011, and currently holds the office of General Secretary of the Karnataka Pradesh Congress Committee.
Share our experiences and our thoughts, but also to exchange views. And this is a platform where I also come to learn something. Thank you. I want to save some time so that the delay can be made up partly. So I try to come straight to the point and also try to as brief as I can, and maybe we can spend a few minutes interacting as well. I've been asked to talk about intergenerational aspects of politics in contemporary context. Frankly, I didn't understand what it meant actually. So I said, and I asked them to help me out, what do you mean by this title? Can you define the title for me? So they weren't very helpful either. They said, you make up something of your own. So I said, all right, let me try. And then I tried to think about it. I couldn't really define it well in a satisfactory way. So I made up a few mishmash of thoughts and some experiences, which are very loosely connected to the topic. So don't hold me to it, is what my appeal is. Now, of course, there's a lot of talk about generational shifts happening in all aspects of life, in business, in society, also in public life. We often hear that younger generation is, newer generation is trying to step into politics. We see some types of politics emerging, which we think are new types of, new generations, new definitions of politics and public life. And a lot of people seem to think that younger generation is by and large better in all aspects. aspects I would agree, but in politics, in my experience, younger generation hasn't really meant anything better, frankly. So this is where I sort of diverge from the consensus on this subject, that younger is definitely, or rather younger is not necessarily better. Because if you look back at the previous generations of personalities in public life, what strikes are their levels of commitment to public life, their definition of what is public life and politics, their vision, and the quality that they brought to public life. So if you apply those parameters to the younger generation that is getting into politics today, many of these aspects are missing. Of course, in popular media, we might see a few younger personalities who might embody these aspects, but those are not, those are few. Those are not all. Neither do they represent the entire younger generation that is coming into public life. So they may perhaps be exceptions. Some of you might have some visuals in mind when you say younger generation of politicians. But by and large, what I see is a deterioration in levels of commitment, in levels of vision they have for public life, their understanding of what is politics. So on all these aspects, the newer generations are not really embodying the best that we have seen in the past. And one thing that bothers even more is their understanding of politics itself. Politics, if we define it as part of legislature, which is one aspect of politics, there is a difference between legislature and what the legislators have to do, and between what the executive has to do. So if you talk to most of the newcomers into public life, they see no difference at all between what is the job of a legislator and that of a public representative, not just legislator, maybe a local body elected member at any level. The difference between the responsibilities of an elected member and that between the official officer of the government. Many a time, these guys think their job is that of a municipal officer or an assistant engineer, or they assume the responsibility of the executive, and they want to be executive rather than elected representative. So this is on the side of the when you talk about intergenerational, this is on the side of the public figures themselves. Of course, intergenerational also applies to the larger public, the elector, the voters. And if you look at them, I mean, I have spent about, now this is my 12th or 13th year in public life, in elected domain. I myself have seen an evolution in them. I also, from a distance, I would observe when my father was in public life, the interactions he would have with the public and the type of interactions we have with the public have undergone a sea change. Those days it was mostly about, they did have expectations of their elected representatives, but it was mostly at the level of a community, at the level of a village, at the level of a society. Today, when most of us interact with our voters, it is very much specific. The interaction is defined on a one-on-one, individual term. So what is it that I can get out of that interaction? What is the benefit for me in this relationship? So you don't measure your public representative or a member of the public life in terms of his or her utility from the community point of view, from a
village point of view, from the constituency point of view, from the society's point of view, but the relationships have narrowed down to what do I get out of this relationship. So from a very public oriented, it has come down to a very personal oriented relationship. This is what I am observing, and this of course comes in the way of politics being done in the right sense of the word, or in the right way. I will tie it in. Recently, some of my experiences, these are very recent experiences, because what I have spoken so far are at a very idea, conceptual level, and I'll try to narrow it down to some of my recent experiences. What do I mean by these? I will not speak much about the aspects within the public representatives, the interactions we have with the public, and the public responses and the dynamics within the society. Now, recently in Karnataka, we conducted a socio-educational survey. The purpose of it was to identify the number of people belonging to various castes and religions that we have. The Supreme Court has many times observed that many of the decisions being made and the many policies being designed in government do not have any hard data to back it. Many of the welfare programs, specifically. So there has been discussion within Government of India and Government of Karnataka for the last more than 10 years that we should have a caste-based census. The last one was done in 1931. So after about 10-12 years of deliberating, recently in Karnataka, we did carry out a census. I'm in charge of a district around Bangalore rural district. So I supervise government activities there. So one of my job was to just see how the survey work is going. So I did a couple of inspections. So I went to the along with the enumerators to see how it is going, how the inspections are. And then subsequently I did a lot of review meetings. And then I started finding out some interesting things. So then I said, okay, let me use my position to learn a few things out of this process. So then I did a few more interactions with the enumerators. So I called a bunch of them, I just made them sit in my office, and I just kept asking them questions. So how was your experience dealing with people? So they came out with a lot of interesting observations, interesting experiences, which also translate into interesting observations of our society. To begin with, in Bangalore rural district, as per the latest census that we carried out, there are about 2,45,000 households. As per the latest survey, this is more than the 2011 census that we had carried out. Now, when there are 2,45,000 families, can you guess the number of families which have already availed of the below poverty line status? Now, let me remind you, Bangalore rural district abuts Bangalore, basically. And Bangalore rural district has some of the extension areas of Bangalore already. For practical purposes, they are extensions of Bangalore. But geographically and revenue-wise, they are just part of, for example, if you take Nelmangala, Taluk, some of those who may be familiar, it's just an extension of Bangalore today. So this is Bangalore rural district. So out of 2,45,000 families that are there, already 2,29,000 of them, households, already have below poverty line. So let me also in the range of starting from 50 lakhs up to 5 crores and excess per acre. Here, you will not find a manual laborer, male or female, for less than 300 rupees a day. There is no way you can find. So if 300 rupees per day is the minimum and you can't find labor at that rate, let's say you just work 20 days a month, so that is a simple 6,000 rupees per month from one person. And many households, there are two income, even if they are manual workers, manual laborers, wage laborers. So anyway, let us just say that one person in a family works, and even if you work 20 days a month, that is 6,000 rupees, right? And the cutoff rate for BPL is 12,000 rupees per annum. So despite these being the parameters, out of 2,45,000, 2,29,000 already have BPL cards. So it doesn't end there. So another 4,456 cards, as of my last review, were cards, meaning below poverty line status cards, were ready to be distributed. So 2,29,000 plus another 4,400 something. And another 4,200 cards were being in the final stages of verification. So on top of 2,29,000, add another 8,000. So approximately about 2,38,000 households would have perhaps by now gotten BPL cards. So that comes to about 97%. So who are the only ones left are the government employees who by default cannot get a BPL card. If you are a government employee, you can't fudge your... Right?
BPL card be withdrawn? Can a person's status go from below to above?
It appears what is happening is that from APL, PPL are above poverty line, they are becoming below poverty line, and not even one is becoming BPL to APL. So that's about 2.38 lakh out of 2.45 will have BPL cards. Perhaps by now they would have all been issued. So add another 7,000 government employees, which is the norm for a district, on a population basis. Just add 3% government employees are anyway there. So if you add that, so that's 100%, 2,45,000. But it still doesn't end there. Right? Another on top of this, 14,800 applications are still pending disposal. On top of this, the story still doesn't end there. On top of all this, there are 39,500 above poverty line cards. So, on a household number of 2,45,000, we have, if you just look at the cards issued and the applications pending, the number comes to 2,96,000. So this is as far as the card situation is concerned. In a district that abuts Bangalore, we have a BPL rate of 95% to 97%, and the total applications and cards ratio is on 2.45, we have 2.96. So this is on the cards front. The other funny thing is, one of the requirements of this survey, the survey we did, primary purpose of the survey was to collect caste and education, which more or less 95% accurate figures we have got. But all these other parameters are just additional information that we were collecting. So one of the things was income. So comical or what. So about 70% of the respondents, of course we'll get the hard data soon, it is going through processing, but this is what I heard from enumerators, 70% of the respondents have marked their income as 11,000 per annum. So 70% of the people seem to have a single level of income within the district. And another aspect is that, you know, when the enumerators went to the households, so two or three brothers and their families are living together as one joint family. But many of them would insist that it be marked in the census that they are living apart as separate households. So this is again to retain their BPL cards or whatever other benefits that they derive that come for an individual household. So of course the enumerator would say, but you are all living together. No, write down, I'm telling you, we are living separately. Of course, the enumerator cannot overrule. Enumerator only has to record what has been told to him or her. He cannot, he or she doesn't have the authority to record the facts. They must record what has been told to them. So, many of them, the enumerator shared with me, were in a dilemma whether to reveal their Aadhaar EPIC card numbers or not. Because they thought, the dilemma was that if they didn't reveal their Aadhaar or EPIC, they were worried that they would lose some of their benefits. But if they did record it, they were worried that the multiple benefits that they were receiving might get lost. So some of them would say, write down my Aadhaar number, and then they would say, no, I don't have an Aadhaar number. And some of them couldn't make up their minds which way to write or not to write. Many of the localities in this area, a lot of garment industries are there. So a lot of men folk and a lot of women folk in these areas work in garment industries. So they would, you know, what is your profession? I'm an employee in a garment industry. And then again it will come down to the income thing. And they would say, okay, what's your income? So there again, they would say, whatever, 11,000 or something. And then the enumerator would ask them, but you know, in the garment industry, the minimum wage you get paid is about 6,000 per month. How can it add up? I mean, it just doesn't add up. You just write down what I'm telling you. And they went to households where in front of them, there is a refrigerator in the house, there is television in the house, and then they would force them to record that there is none of that in the house. These are not exceptions what I am sharing with you. This is by and large, 50 to 7% of the respondents, this was the experience. And then there would be a car standing in front of their house, a tractor standing in front of their house. So, is this car yours? No, it is my neighbor's, it is not mine. Don't record I have a car. So when all this drama was happening, some of the enumerators shared with me that sometimes the children would be standing around. So the parents would become very uncomfortable to do all this jugglery in front of their children, and many of them would ask their children to go inside when they are responding. Because the children might speak up and say, no, either adu nandu kaaru nandu use. So you can't manage the children sometimes. Things like this. So it went on and on. I mean, they narrated many things. Of course, one of the disturbing things, I mean, this is also disturbing, but the other disturbing thing I also heard, which is not related to the point I'm trying to make, I'm just in a minute or two, I'll come to the point I'm trying to make. Besides that, the point was that they felt, you know, they would go to some of these houses where a lot of renters were there, families, families, migrant families living in rented houses, and the owner lives in the same building. Probably next door the owner is living, and this side of the house the renter is